They live in these very dimly lit, deep portions of the ocean, and when the sun goes down, they actually swim up miles into the shallower waters where there's a lot more productivity, a lot more food. So they feed on animals in the deep sea, and they also avoid being eaten.
Welcome to Wavelengths, where we talk about our planet with experts from Scripps Institution of Oceanography, covering everything from the deep sea to the edge of the atmosphere. I'm Kate Furby, a marine biologist and journalist. I got my PhD here a few years ago, and now I'm back, learning more about what's happening at Scripps. I'm here today with Dr. Anela Choy. She's an assistant professor at Scripps Oceanography. She studies deep sea food webs. So every night these animals are coming up from the depths. What scale are we talking about for this?
Yeah, well, let's remember that these are pretty small animals. Sometimes they're this big to, this big. And they're swimming hundreds of feet up and down in the ocean every single day. And when you're this big, it's basically like running a marathon every single day just to get your meal.
And you look at how everything is connected?
Yeah, we look at through how animals are connected through feeding. So predator-prey interactions. We look at diet, we look at trophic levels, which is basically where in the food web an animal is feeding, and how all of those different steps lead up to top predators. Things are pretty complicated in the ocean. Animals are adapted to eat a wide variety of different animals because in the deep sea, you never know when your next meal is gonna come.
I could never live there.
I couldn't either.
I have snacks in my pocket right now. So how do you do the research that you're doing?
Yeah, we rely on a number of different tools to basically bring us into the deep sea. And we use a lot of remotely operated vehicles, a lot of deep diving robots. We send down trawls, and we also look at the diets of animals who are basically sampling this midwater community for us.
Is that where this guy comes in?
Yeah, so in this jar is a really large, long-nosed lancet fish.
I was gonna ask you what the lancet fish eats, but looking at his face, it looks like whatever he wants. What do they actually eat?
Well, I'd like, maybe you'll see for yourself.
We're not gonna be good at this.
That's okay.
Okay.
I think you can remember how to use the scissors, right?
Wow.
So there's a piece of plastic you can see right away, along with all of the different prey items in this stomach. Kate has some of these. These are hatchet fish.
Oh my God. whoa. Wow.
So there's a large shard of plastic as well, and you can see it has some kind of like biofouling on it.
Yeah.
So it may have been in the ocean for some amount of time.
Cool. I find it like pretty upsetting that we've found plastic in all of these ocean ecosystems, particularly like the deep sea that's so remote. Mm-hmm.
And I think it's really important that we use this knowledge in a positive way. And we use it to show people how they are connected to the deep sea, not just through the plastic products that they use every day, but the food that we eat, the cars that we drive and the planes that we fly, the devices that we use in our pockets every single day. A lot of these resources come from the deep sea.
That's a really inspirational way to think about the plastic problem. I think the idea that that's really compelling is that all of the ocean animals are connected, but we're also part of that ecosystem.